Hayward police are now looking for a man accused of killing his former wife. This happened less than a week ago at her home in Hayward. Investigators say their suspect is armed and dangerous.
This senseless thing happened can shatter a family.
This was Monique Aldrige. She was 30 years old, a fitness instructor, a mom, and a soon-to-be mother of two. She was also a bright, kind person who had a long life ahead of her and a chance at happiness with another partner. But Monique and her unborn baby met an unspeakable fate at the hands of a man who once claimed he loved her deeply. How can you profess your love to a person then choose to end their life? That's not love. That's possession, obsession, and evil. Vaughn Boatner was not a loving partner or dad. He was a real-life monster, seeing his ex-wife as property and their son as a reminder of his loss. He left a 5-year-old boy without his parents and stole two souls from this world in a sick attempt to have the last word. This is the tragic story of Monique Aldrige.
Mr. Boatner and our homicide victim, Monique Aldrige, were previously in a relationship with each other, and the 5-year-old child located at the home at the time of the shooting was their son.
It was a sunny afternoon on May 11th, 2023, in Hayward, California, when authorities were called to a home in a quiet area at around 2 p.m. Someone had heard gunshots coming from inside the house, and they feared the worst. Sadly, by the time the officers barged into the house, it was a little too late. Monique Aldrige lay on her bed with 7 gunshot marks in her head. Her boyfriend, Jackson, was also hit in the stomach.
It is believed both shooting victims were in a dating relationship and lived together at the time of this incident.
Jackson and Monique were rushed to the nearest hospital, while the officers stayed behind and secured the scene. After several days in critical condition, Jackson would miraculously pull through. 30-year-old Monique Aldrige, however, was pronounced dead at the hospital a mere hour after she was found at her home. The doctors also noted she was pregnant. This was a devastating end to a life so young, and the loss of her unborn baby made it all the more heartbreaking. It would be a tough challenge for the detectives to deliver this news to Monique's family.
It's been a very, very difficult time for us, quite naturally. A lot of us are still pretty much trying to cope with it and, you know, some state of shock, you know, for the most part.
But it was Monique's family who had a name in mind, Vaughn Boatner. Only Monique's bitter ex could have done this.
Hayward police are now looking for Aldrige's ex-husband, Vaughn Boatner of San Mateo. Investigators say he went to Aldrige's home in Hayward, where she lived with her boyfriend, and shot both of them.
Hayward police are now looking for a man accused of killing his former wife. This happened less than a week ago at her home in Hayward. Investigators say their suspect is armed and dangerous.
Yeah, it would take a pretty long time until Vaughn would be behind bars and the full story would be revealed. Hayward has 160,000 inhabitants, and it's the 6th largest city in the Bay Area. It's as sunny and friendly as San Francisco, but less expensive, chaotic, or dangerous. In fact, Hayward is pretty attractive to young families, as it's loaded with parks, cute coffee shops, and job opportunities without the hassles of a big city. 30-year-old Monique Aldrige and her 5-year-old boy were a young family. It was just the two of them, and they were as thick as thieves. Hayward was perfect for them. Shorelines, playgrounds, shopping malls, and of course an opening for a fitness business. You see, Monique was really into healthy living. She had a job in healthcare, was a sports enthusiast, and had a dream to open up her own private training business. She was over the moon that, before she reached the big 30, she was a happy mom and the proud owner of such a place.
Hello, I'm Monique. I am the founder of Rdered Beans. Fitness has been a passion of mine for the past 5 years, and personal training is my purpose. And I'm so excited to share what I've learned throughout my journey with you all, so feel free to holler at me, and let's go.
Monique's family was so proud of her. It wasn't just that she'd hit all these milestones so early in life. In fact, they never pressed her to get married or get a degree or a high-paying job. Her goal-getter, hard-working attitude was her own, and she'd shown it since she was a toddler. There wasn't an idle moment in her life. She would always find a project of her own or a way to help someone she cared for. She was a great listener and the kind of friend who wanted to see everyone succeed. By the time she was a teenager, Monique had realized that by succeeding, she meant being healthy. She knew a healthy mind can only rest in a healthy body. That is, if you're fit and healthy, your mood improves tenfold, and she wanted all her loved ones to live a long and happy life. It's a really sad irony that she didn't get to life a long and happy life herself. Monique graduated from high school when she was only 16. Then, she graduated from the University of California in Davis with a degree in biology. Barely past the age of 20, she got a job in healthcare and started working toward her lifelong goals. But Monique wasn't just about a career. Her goals also included finding a steady, loving partner and being a mom. In her early 20s, she met and married Vaughn Boatner. She was 3 years his junior, and Vaughn seemed like a well-off, confident man who could provide as well as take care of her. But Vaughn was one of those charmers, a talker, not a doer. He was the kind of man who would shower Monique with gifts or compliments, but only when he wanted something in return. Once he'd obtained her affection, the gifts stopped pouring. And when a baby came around, Vaughn wasn't nearly as involved as Monique would have liked him to be. For her, they were now a family of three. They had to stick together and work toward raising their son into a happy, healthy adult. For Vaughn, well, it's hard to say what he thought or felt. It's always hard to analyze a real-life monster from a human perspective. Vaughn was a bit of a player. He was more concerned with how he looked on social media or going to parties than being a husband or a dad. He also didn't work much, and this bothered Monique. She was hoping her husband would take life a little more seriously now that he was married with kids. But Monique was the type of person who saw the good in people and always tried to better herself. Sadly, not everyone is prone to self-improvement. Some people refuse to look in the mirror or ask themselves what they could do to be better, kinder, or happier. Some people just live from day to day, and when something goes wrong, they blame someone else and carry on. When Monique wanted a second baby, she had a serious talk with Vaughn. Was he in? Could he get a higher-paying job and stick around the house a little more? The answer was a flat no. Vaughn felt pressured by his wife to do more and be more. Why couldn't she just accept him for who he was? Monique explained why she and their son needed him, but Vaughn couldn't really see reason. So Monique broke things off. She decided she would do a better job as a single mom than carrying Vaughn, as if he were another child, not a husband. For her, it was a fresh start. Of course, no breakup is easy, especially when there are marriage certificates, houses, and kids involved. But to Monique, it felt a little liberating. She had been in a toxic relationship for a bit too long, and she was happy to accept that some people, Vaughn included, just don't change. But to Vaughn, it was his worst nightmare. He could not imagine life without Monique, and he couldn't bear the thought that she was happy without him. As resentment took over him, he let his worst thoughts become reality. Monique was in her late 20s when she met another man named Jackson Field. He was kind and patient, and Monique's little son loved him too. He had that good energy that makes kids feel safe and loved, and a joy of life that Monique had never seen in a man before. Jackson was happy to welcome Monique and her son into his life, and the three of them soon became a family, moving in together into a new home. In the spring of 2023, Monique learned she was pregnant. The couple was over the moon. Their happy family was expanding, and Monique felt that, for the first time, her partner would be there every step of the way. When the detectives learned Monique's story, the scenario became pretty clear. Vaughn already hated Monique for breaking up with him. Now, when he heard the news that she was pregnant, he was infuriated. This meant Monique had moved on and was happy without him. He could not stand the thought, so he decided to end her. Y'all, it's pretty sad that this is not a unique scenario, and that it was so easy for the authorities to figure out what had happened. This only shows how often this happens.
Mike, the Hayward Police Department says it is working with other law enforcement agencies, including the U.S. Marshals, to locate and arrest the suspect. The victim's family tells me they are in shock over what happened.
Vaughn did not turn himself in. He could not accept responsibility for what he'd done. Instead, he fled the scene and tried to find a place where no one would be looking for him.
Mr. Boatner fled his residence just prior to the service of a search warrant on May 11th, and he remains at large. He should be considered armed and dangerous.
His wanted poster was put up all over California, and the Hayward Department notified every other department in the state to be on high alert. Meanwhile, Monique's family learned something else. Her 5-year-old son was in the house when it all went down. Can you imagine taking your ex's life while your own kid is there? Honestly, what kind of person is Vaughn Boatner?
Investigators say when the shooting happened, the woman's 5-year-old son was also at the scene, and police say they believe the shooter is the boy's father, and the other victim was in a relationship with the deceased woman.
We're gonna have to have a sit down with him and explain to him the circumstances and then also provide some counseling. It's gonna be a long, hard road for us, you know, quite naturally. We're still trying to process it.
It's Monique's grieving family that is now taking care of her son.
Chief Matthews says the boy was not harmed and is safe with family shortly after several neighbors reported gunshots that deadly afternoon.
But imagine losing both your parents in one shocking incident. How will he ever feel, knowing that his dad unalived his pregnant mom and didn't even care that he was there? He didn't think what he would do to his son, not for one second. When the detectives reached Vaughn's home with a search warrant, he just fled.
Investigators attempted to serve a search warrant at Boatner's home in San Mateo, but he was already gone.
This was not a random act of violence. That these folks had a previous relationship and knew each other.
$10,000 were offered as a reward to anyone who could help authorities arrest Vaughn Boatner. And while local authorities were out looking for him, detectives learned he fled the state.
There is a warrant out for Boatner's arrest. The U.S. Marshals Service is involved in the investigation and is offering a $10,000 reward for information that leads to his arrest and conviction.
Vaughn was finally tracked down to Seattle, where he was arrested by a huge task force made of local authorities and members of the Kings County Sheriff's Office.
Kalina's ex-wife in Hayward has been taken into custody. Hayward police say U.S. Marshals took Vaughn Boatner into custody in Seattle yesterday afternoon. Investigators say they believe he shot his ex-wife, Monique Aldrige, in Hayward earlier this month, as well as her boyfriend.
Indeed, even though several weeks had passed since Monique's death, the news still explained that authorities believed Vaughn had taken her life. They could not say for sure, not until they had all the evidence needed to convict him. So he was arrested on suspicion of murder and booked into county jail. He was also charged with attempted homicide, child endangerment, and being a felon in possession of a firearm. Yep, he already was a convicted felon for firearm possession and white powder possession. He also had a pending case for robbery.
Mr. Boatner has prior convictions for gun possession, possession of cocaine for sale. He had a pending robbery case at the time of these murders.
Talk about a great dad. Monique was better off without him, and she knew it. He was held without bail and set to be extradited to California.
I have authorized a gun enhancement and the extradition from Washington State to California of defendant Vaughn Boatner.
While Vaughn waited for his trial, Monique's family and friends and people all over the country struggled to cope with the shock of her case. And as it happens in cases like Monique's, people were also sure to discuss a way too recurrent issue, gun violence. Alameda County District Attorney Pamela Price explained why she added the gun enhancement charge to Vaughn Boatner's list. In this instance, we believe the major gun enhancement is appropriate in this egregious violent crime. The message I will continue to repeat is that our special directive doesn't prohibit all gun enhancements. Each crime requires a painstaking evaluation of the evidence and the circumstances. Unless required by law or excluded from the policy, enhancements are not going to be automatically applied. They will be used sparingly when appropriate, as in this case. Without the gun enhancement charge, Vaughn could face 25 years to life in prison. With the charge, it'll be 50 years to life for taking Monique's life, and another 32 to life for trying to unalive Jackson too. The message is clear. It's way too easy to take a life with a gun. It should not be this easy, and people should be discouraged from resorting to gun violence to solve their issues.
Tonight, chilling video taken by a 20-year-old woman who was murdered just moments later. Her 18-year-old boyfriend accused of pulling the trigger that ended her life.
You think I'm playing, huh?
Okay.
You think I'm playing, huh? Hit you with this big 4-5 hollow tips, gonna eat your up.
Those angry, hate-filled words and despicable actions from her boyfriend, 18-year-old Kevin Dixon, police say. A young man who was supposed to love India, but this is anything but.
India Elise Mucky was 20 years old when her life was callously taken by her enraged boyfriend, 18-year-old Kevin Dixon. Authorities found India's lifeless body on the passenger seat of her boyfriend's car. Dixon was speeding and swerving around in Warren, Michigan, with his girlfriend's body right next to him. Were he not speeding, he would not have been pulled over that night.
East Point PD gets all these calls about a white van that's driving erratically over the road.
Shocked and disgusted, the officers arrested Kevin for murder. murder. He said no way. His girlfriend had just had a terrible accident and he was driving her to the hospital. But within a few hours, he told just about a dozen lies, and the officers knew he was guilty. They also went through India's phone, which Dixon still had on him. In her phone was a very recent video shot just hours before Dixon's arrest. India had filmed her own death. A day after her 20th birthday, she met Kevin for a drive around town, but they soon started fighting and, to her shock, he pulled out a firearm and began loading it. Fearing the worst, India started filming.
You think I'm playing, huh?
Okay.
You think I'm playing, huh? Hit you with this big 4-5 hollow tips, gonna eat your up.
At one point in the video, Dixon is seen cleaning his fingerprints, almost ostentatiously. He knew what he was about to do, and he was rubbing it in India's face. Imagine what India's family felt when the detectives notified them of her passing. Even worse, they told them they had the recorded moment when she drew her last breath out of her monster boyfriend's hands.
The last thing her family has of her is the video where she is pointing the camera at the man who's gonna kill her.
It's absolutely shocking to watch how little emotion this teen boy shows in the video as he prepares to take his girlfriend's life. He even taunts her and plays to the camera, even though he knows the recording will work against him in the future. And when India's horrific case made headlines, it was alongside a discussion of DV and gun violence.
In just the last couple of months, law enforcement has seen 6 domestic violence homicides. It's sad, startling, and alarming.
In January 2019, ABC reported that half of the identified many homicide in 2018 in the U.S. were instances of intimate partners or family violence. 7 of those 10 cases involved men fatally shooting either their girlfriend, wife, or ex-partner, along with at least 3 other people. Some of those other victims were relatives of the female victim, others were bystanders. 2 of the 10 cases involved a familial homicide, with parents or children their direct relatives. The numbers are huge, and yet they are not nearly as talked about as other violent incidents in the country. Brian Pacheco, the spokesperson for a support agency called Safe Horizon, explained, "For so long, we've seen domestic violence as a personal issue. It happens in the home, don't talk about it, but mass shootings show us otherwise. These are not just personal issues. These are community issues that we all should be tackling. The ability to help and support one survivor has the potential to save so many lives." Here's an even grimmer stat. A 2017 United Nations report concluded that, especially for women, some of the deadliest dangers are at home. Over 58% of women who are intentionally murdered around the world lose their lives at the hands of an intimate partner or family member. A staggering 82% of victims are female in intimate partner homicide cases. This puts India and Monique's tragedies in perspective. Not only are they not alone in the United States, they is not alone in the world. This is still a major problem in almost all countries of the world in the 2020s, a time known for more peace and prosperity than at any other time in history. Sadly, teenage girls and young women are the most prone to the type of manipulation and violence that eventually leads to murder.
The young mother who was gunned down 3 months after giving birth to premature twins.
"My daughter did not deserve this, and I want the killer to go to jail forever."
She was really happy to be a mom. She went all out. She was really proud of girls, too. That's what she really wanted, was girls. She got her dream.
On June 15th, 2021, Crystal Crockett spent her day with her 3-month-old twin girls in Chicago. She had given birth to them prematurely, and she wanted nothing more than to care for them and nurture them to good health and happiness.
She was really happy to be a mom. She went all out. She was really proud of girls, too. That's what she really wanted, was girls. She got her dream.
But the twins' father had another plan that day.
Prosecutors say the father of the babies, 31-year-old Elijah Clifford, shot Crystal in cold blood in an alley at 45th and Wabash.
Crystal and Elijah's relationship had been strained for some time, and when Crystal became pregnant, it all went south even faster. But now Crystal had other priorities. She knew she wanted to be the best mother she could possibly be for her girls, and her relationship with Elijah would be on the second place. She would try and fix things, but if they couldn't be fixed, she was happy to be a single mom too, just like Monique. But the more Crystal asserted her freedom, the more controlling Elijah would become. He would tell her how he wanted her to behave around him and other people. And when she didn't behave exactly like he wanted her to, he would become aggressive. First came the nasty words, then the turned physical, emotional, and worse. Her family would beg her to leave this horrible entanglement. But Crystal kept hoping Elijah would change, even when she came home with bruises and scratches. By the time she had her babies, Crystal was paralyzed with fear in her relationship. She was so scared of Elijah that she feared dumping him would lead him to take her or her baby's lives. He often threatened to off her if she thought about leaving him, so she just did what he told her to and hoped for the best. But one day, Elijah picked his girlfriend up from the NICU after she visited her premature babies, let her climb into his car, pulled out his firearm, aimed at her head, and fired. He offed her anyway, despite her decision to stick around.
Hospital video showed the couple at the hospital the day before, and surveillance video shows the couple early the next morning, Clippered with a gun, shooting her several times.
Sometimes, it really seems like there's no escape from such monsters. What can you do to run and live safely away from a partner like this? Once you realize he's a walking, talking red flag. Monique couldn't run, India couldn't run, and neither could Crystal. Meanwhile, the stats add up. More women are unalived each year by partners or ex-partners firing firearms after an argument or a breakup. But Monique, or India, or Crystal aren't stats. They're people with rich inner lives, hopes, dreams, and the right to live. They deserved more. India and Crystal's killers are now rotting in prison. Prosecutors are hoping the same for Monique's killer, Vaughn Boatner. As of March 2024, he is still awaiting his trial, waiting in a California jail with no bond. Monique's family is hoping for the longest sentence possible for Vaughn. They are also hoping they can help her son recover from the unspeakable trauma he went through. But no matter how much prison time Vaughn gets, their lives will never be the same without Monique. Thanks for tuning in, y'all. What are your thoughts on Monique's case? Do you know similar stories? Let me know in a comment below. And make sure you like and subscribe before you leave. See you next time.